Good evening and welcome to this edition of County Connection. I'm your host for this evening, County Commissioner Kevin Barnhardt. Jean Tusi could not be with us this evening. Hope she's doing fine. My guest this evening is Ryan Hunter. He's the Director of Facilities and Operations for the County of Berks. Welcome, Ryan.
Thank you for having me.
And we're going to be discussing tonight NACO, the National Association of Counties, and the National Counties Month is April. And the initiative that NACO has us looking at is infrastructure and transportation. NACO is a nationwide organization of counties who basically deal with issues that are facing counties across the United States in association with CCAP, which is the County Commissioners Association of Pennsylvania, which the county commissioners of Berks County are members of both. Our chair of the board, Christian Leinbach, is a member of NACO's board of directors, and we also serve on the CCAP board of directors as well. So it's a good time for us to discuss infrastructure, transportation, how it relates to the County of Berks. NACO, as I said, represents all the counties in the United States, and many counties are structured different than the counties in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Many counties across the country have a lot more bridges, roads, highways, and infrastructure. It's more of a county-centric type function. Here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, the majority of roads are owned and maintained by PennDOT, to a large extent, a lot of municipalities, townships, boroughs, and cities, and counties have a like share as well. Here in Berks County, we have about 59 bridges and one small road, which is County Welfare Road, which is up at the North Campus to Berksheim and the Berks County Prison. So we want to cover the county assets as well as some of the things taking place right here in the greater Reading area with Ryan. Ryan, as I said, is our Facilities and Operations Director for the County of Berks, and he wants to start off by explaining to us what's taking place on these four concrete spans on the Schuylkill River.
I assume you're referencing the four leading in and out of the city, right?
Yes, those four concrete spans.
Four notorious bridges. Well,
yes.
As you know, some of them have been subject to some temporary repairs. Some of them have been subject to permanent repairs. And we've got some very major projects on the horizon. I'll start with some of those. The 183 bridge, Schuylkill Avenue. That bridge has been under lane restrictions, undergoing a pretty significant rehabilitation for the last couple of years. That project, the end is near. They expect construction to wrap up in around June for that project. Also, as you know, the Bingham Street Bridge was subject to some unanticipated repairs, some lane restrictions as a result of an inspection conducted by PennDOT. But those repairs have been completed. The bridge, I believe, is now back open to all legal loads and will be so throughout for the foreseeable future, although there is a full-scale rehabilitation of that bridge planned several years down the line.
In the distant future. Right, so Schuylkill Avenue and Bingham Street are both state-owned PennDOT bridges.
Correct.
Rehabilitation of Schuylkill Avenue, Bingham is going to be much beyond maybe another 6 or 8 years till we see something there. We've received information from folks who are driving on the Bingham Street Bridge, mm-hmm. Concerned about the massive potholes. We have been in touch with PennDOT representatives that we know at the county level through the Transportation Study Committee and trying to see if they can put some sort of a skim coat or something over that, at least to ease the burden for the commuters for the next 6 or 8 years until they really rebuild that whole bridge. So,
correct.
And now the big one.
Now the big one.
The drum roll.
Of the four, the one that is county-owned is Buttonwood Street Bridge. That bridge has been let for bids by PennDOT jointly with the Federal Highway Administration and the county. Those bids came in on April 2nd. And you and your colleagues will be in a position to award or at least notify PennDOT of your concurrence with the low bid this coming Thursday. So what that means is we are ramping up now towards getting started with construction. Once the county provides concurrence, several wheels go into motion at the state level, and we'll be looking to probably issue notice to proceed to the contractor some point in mid-May. And at that point, the contractor has a contractual obligation to provide a minimum of 30 days notice before they would close the bridge and get ready for and actually commence work. And that 30 days notice comes complete with putting up signage. You've seen sometimes those big orange signs say this bridge will be closed on X and X date. The contractor has an obligation to do that, as well as make sure that all temporary traffic controls, temporary lights, signs pertaining to the detour routes are in place before they can actually close the bridge and get started.
So what will people expect to see 30 days out from the actual bridge closure? Will they be aware of the detours, where the detours are? Will there be any kind of restrictions on the bypass, which goes underneath the Buttonwood Street Bridge?
There will be some select restrictions on the bypass, particularly when there's work occurring overhead. Most of the work on the bypass or on the spans that cross the bypass is going to occur at night. It'll occur with lane restrictions. It's really the only way you can do it. It would just be too much of a problem logistically and quite frankly, a safety risk to try to do that type of work when the hustle and bustle of the peak travel times is occurring underneath the bridge. So that work on those spans will occur primarily at night with lane restrictions. Evening time, dusk, you'll see the crews mobilize. Work will go through the overnight hours and be basically out of the way to the greatest extent possible once the morning commute starts up.
Ryan, help us understand the magnitude of the cars that are carried on Schuylkill Avenue, Bingman Street, Buttonwood, and then Penn Street. Tell us volume numbers so people can get some perspective of how many thousands of cars move here.
I believe Buttonwood sees about 16,000 cars a day, and that's just a tremendous amount. It's obviously the single largest in terms of average daily traffic that the count of all the county assets
bridges
that we own. That's cars. It probably sees hundreds, if not thousands, more pedestrians that use the bridge as a conduit between the city of Reading and West Reading, whether they're walking to work, whether they're walking for social endeavors on either side of the river. So that's a lot of people that will have a direct impact once this bridge gets closed. And make no mistake, the bridge does have to be closed in its entirety. The utilities that are going to be relocated are in the chases that are underneath the sidewalk. So we can't leave the bridge open to pedestrians while we do the work, nor can we leave it down with as the Schuylkill Avenue Bridge was, where we just had sort of half of it shut down at a time, and while we worked on the other half. Unfortunately, just the phasing and the logistics of the work that has to occur at Buttonwood prevents that.
Now let's emphasize that the other three spans, Schuylkill Avenue, Bingham Street, and then ultimately Penn Street, are all PennDOT bridges. Buttonwood Street is a county-owned bridge. The bridge that will be closed down to all pedestrian vehicular traffic is Buttonwood Street because of the way it's designed and built.
Correct.
And that one carries more pedestrians.
Right.
Walking to and from Vanity Fair, Reading Health System, the nursing homes, and back and forth. So we are working on community outreach with the Borough of West Reading, with the City of Reading, and having we're planning in May to have some community meetings with the folks to recognize that there may be some alternatives with park and ride, with utilizing BART to bus, as well as with commuter services to do some carpooling. Mm-hmm. So we understand the need that people have to get to and from work and to play, and we're trying to take care of that as much as possible. If you will, stick with Buttonwood for a minute, Ryan, and explain to the viewers how long this process, or even just taking the Buttonwood Street Bridge, the process from the time that the owner knows that it needs to be rehabilitated till the time it's completed. I think people have to really understand that this is not something that is a turnkey operation and 3 months later, boom, you start the work.
Right. The planning that goes into a project of this magnitude is astronomical. To draw it into consideration, Buttonwood is sort of, we refer to it sort of as the perfect storm in bridges, because it's got spans that not only cross the Schuylkill River, it's got spans that cross roadways that are owned by the City of Reading and the Borough of West Reading. It spans railroad tracks owned by Norfolk Southern. It spans Route 422, so you have a major highway. So during the planning phases, when decisions need to be made or plans need to be made, consider the number of parties that have to be consulted in order to make that party. Not just the City of Reading and the Borough of the West Reading County, but also PennDOT, Norfolk Southern, Pennsylvania Historic Museum Commission, because the bridge is historically relevant, Department of Environmental Protection, you name it, Fish and Boat. We've received correspondence from the United States Coast Guard. It's amazing the number of clearances, opportunities for consultation that needs to go into getting a project like this to the point where we can actually start the work. And then once we start the work, it's 2 years of hard labor getting the bridge back to where it needs to be in order to carry all legal loads.
So it's literally 2 to 3 times the amount of planning before the actual reconstruction takes place. Literally 6, 7, 8 years till you get to that 2 year time frame.
Right.
And then some of that stuff expires.
If
you don't get to it soon enough, and we
permitting
ingest
clearances,
like bog turtle habitats, I think they expire in a 3 year period of time. So if you're doing a bridge and you have to get the required permitting to make sure bog turtles are not migrating, mm-hmm. and you don't commence to work within 3 years, you have to start over again.
Yep.
Before I forget, this is a call-in show. The home viewers, it's 610-378-0426. And tonight is a NACO, National Association of Counties program on bridges and infrastructure. I'm your guest host, Kevin Barnhardt, filling in for Gene Tusi with the Director of Facilities and Operations, Ryan Hunter from the county. And one to let you know, the sponsor tonight is South Central Transit Agency, which is the combination of Red Rose, the bus transportation company in Lancaster, and BARTA, which is the bus transportation firm in Reading that came together beginning of this year to provide more efficient service for folks in Lancaster and Berks County. Wanted to put that little plug in there.
Hey.
And while we were looking at these bridge closures, not so much Schuylkill Avenue, and we were surprised by Binghamton Street, speaking to Gail Landis at the Chamber of Commerce, we said, you know what, Buttonwood Street is going to go down, 16,000 cars, we'll have to find another way to get in and out of the city. And being a member of the Chamber, as the county is, and looking at the impact on employees and jurors and folks that come in for entertainment, and conversely, people who want to go over and shop in Wyomissing, West Reading, want to work in West Reading and Wyomissing, it's going to be difficult. So we wanted to make sure that people were fully aware of what was going to happen, where the lane restrictions were, where the limitations were. So a public-private partnership was created well over a year and a half ago by the Chamber of Commerce and the County of Berks and other entities to create readingbridges.net. It could be readingbridges.com, but that's Reading, England has already taken, our sister city has taken that from us. But it's an interactive website. We put up as much information as we can, the history of the bridges as well as what's taking place. But we look at the Buttonwood Street Bridge as a test case and a model being completely closed, 16,000 cars a day. Once that's back up and operational, then the Penn Street Bridge goes into a major rehabilitation. Would you like to go into some of the details on that, Ryan?
Yeah, I mean, that's the Buttonwood. I don't want to say it's the first domino to fall, but I mean, it's a very critical one. And what's probably most critical about the entire project is when it's done. Mm-hmm. Because as soon as it's done, then we're going to roll right into, and I say we are become a consulting party because Penn Street is a state-owned bridge. So, but nevertheless, it has a significant regional impact in and out of the city of Reading. But as soon as Buttonwood Street is done, it becomes a detour route for the work that will happen that will restrict traffic on Penn Street. Penn Street will not be a complete closure. That will be accomplished with lane restrictions similar to the 183 Schuylkill Avenue Bridge. But nevertheless, people are going to need to find alternative ways in and out of the city. Thankfully, by that point, we'll have a brand new Buttonwood Street Bridge, which will be able to handle all legal loads.
Which doesn't at this point. You can't run trucks across the bridge.
Correct. Right. Correct. It's a posted bridge. And that's mainly for the preservation of the asset, mm-hmm. More than its structural capacity. But nevertheless, one of the objectives with any bridge project should be removing all problems with it that may cause it to be structurally deficient or functionally obsolete or what have you. So,
the vehicle load on Penn Street, 34,000 cars?
I believe that's about right, yeah.
34,000 cars a day. Again, that's why the readingbridges.net is so important. One of the facets of what we're working on, not only to inform people about detours, and just jumping back to Buttonwood, I don't want to confuse people. Buttonwood Street Bridge, when that is closed, when you come out of the city of Reading across to Penn Street Bridge, they will have 3rd Avenue and 4th Avenue closed to make a left-hand turn. For example, if you're turning to go back into the first two arteries into West Reading for that two-year period, you'll have to go up to 5th Avenue and make a left, which heads down toward the Reading Health Systems complex. So that's to afford the opportunity for the cars to go straight up two lanes and then merge into the 5th Avenue. Mm-hmm. These are things that are necessary. That's why we've engaged the merchants in West Reading mm-hmm. to let them know they're going to be putting information in their stores, pamphlets in their stores, so that we don't want to impact business and mm-hmm. commerce Obviously, a rehabilitated bridge will help us to run trucks back and forth as they should be through Buttonwood Street Corridor into the interstate industrial collector for people doing business in the city. So it's a process that we have to get out there and inform people and let them know. We just don't want people to wake up one morning and decide to come into Reading and say, I can't get across the Buttonwood Street Bridge. And it's all about also keeping and maintaining the vibrancy of downtown Reading with the arena, with the Sovereign Performing Arts Center, Santander Performing Arts Center, the Goggle Works, IMAX Theater, the Peanut Bar, the list goes on and on. We want people to understand way ahead of time that there are ways in and out of the city and not to restrict their travel by the fact that one bridge will be down. The Penn Street Bridge, the lane, the eastmost lane, the one that comes up from Exeter, I think they call that Ramp K, will be closed completely for the entire duration of that project, which is well over, it's going to be 2+ years, probably more like 2.5 years. So the two lanes will be coming out Penn Street, and then one lane will be going into Reading based on the volume coming out during rush hours. So we have a lot on the plate. These are multi-million dollar projects.
Yes.
The Buttonwood Street went out, is going to be approved Thursday at just under $12 million.
Yep, about $11.7
million. Ryan, where does all this money come from?
Well, in this case, in the case of Buttonwood, it is the project is federally funded. It's Federal Highway Administration dollars. It's an 80% federal and 20% state match. So there's no
fuel tax.
Yes, yes. There's no county money that's going into these particular bridges. That said, the county does have proprietary funding that it does receive through a couple of different channels that we can use to for the betterment of our county-owned improvement or transportation assets.
County so even owns though Buttonwood Street Bridge is the county's asset, you're able to leverage federal and state money.
Correct.
That's a process.
Correct.
Right.
Like, it's a process, like anything else. You have to demonstrate the regional significance of your project. A project like Buttonwood has a much greater chance of getting that federal funding than a project that's situated in a much more rural area that sees, you know, a fraction of the traffic every single day.
So volume is pretty indicative of whether you're going to receive federal and state.
Yeah, and I think that it's how regional of an asset, how vital of an artery is it, plays pretty heavily into the decision-making process. At the county level, we also get liquid fuels money, which is, again, the gas tax. It's a little bit different. The allocation that the county gets is a little bit different than that which municipalities get.
I want to explain that to the viewers.
Sure.
The allocation of liquid fuels money for the county.
Yeah. A lot of municipalities, your townships, your boroughs, their allocation of liquid fuels money is typically based on the amount of roads that they own, the amount of bridges that they have almost to a mileage. Mm-hmm. There's an allocation formula that takes the amount that they own and cranks out a dollar amount accordingly. For the counties, it's a different formula. I don't know why it hasn't been updated, but it's basically a formula based on the ratio of the county's gas consumption for the calendar years 1927, 1928, and 1929, when compared to the Commonwealth's overall consumption for those same 3 years. So Berks County had a little bit more robust of a automobile boom at that time, so we tend to fare pretty favorably when compared to some other counties. But that's how the county's allocation
and it hasn't
is
changed
out.
Since 27, 28, and 29.
Nope.
Maybe in 2027, 28, and 29, maybe they'll recalculate it.
100-year
anniversary.
Hopefully,
Harrisburg will figure this out, that they're 100 years behind the times.
Right, exactly. But it equates to be a little bit less than $1 million a year that the county gets. Which, as you stated earlier, you know, one project, Buttonwood Street, is $11.7 million with the awarded bids. So that money, you know, can go very, very quickly, even when accrued over several years. But nevertheless, we do use that money for our bridge and roadway improvements. We also receive a select allocation from the Act 13 money. Okay. Those are the county's allocation from the impact fees that are gathered through the Marcellus Shale operations. That comes out to be about $600,000, a little bit more than that, for transportation. There's also separate monies that goes towards parks and rec. And then there's a handful of other smaller means.
And now the new Act 89 money that's coming through with the wholesale gas tax.
Yes.
So we're looking at federal money, state money, Act 13 shale money, Act 89 enhancement from 2013. So what I think we're seeing is that the decades of neglect, not just in the Commonwealth, but specifically in Berks County, we're able to sometime in the future turn the corner and bring up some of these substandard roadways and bridges and highways up to modern standards, but it's not going to happen overnight. It's going to take us probably 10 to 15 years to get there because it didn't happen overnight.
Sure.
And I've said this three times in the past week. We can't shut down every bridge or lane restrict every road and put up detour signs all over Berks County. We still have to have a good flow of traffic in and out of Berks County down through our major arteries. Route 61, for example, was down to lane restriction for several years. Mm-hmm. I think that's soon to be reopened in its entirety. There are certainly plans in the near future for widening 222 North and roundabouts being placed in there. That's going to, you know, stay open, but there's mm-hmm. going to be some lane restrictions there as well. And it's interesting, I think, to put it into focus, the county receives just under $1 million in liquid fuels money. But tell us about the bridges and the assets the county has. We do have quite a number.
Yes, we have 59 bridges. They're in varying stages of vintage, shall we say, from bridges that are brand new. In fact, we've got one Burn Station Bridge that connects Perry and Tilden Township that will be reopened to traffic in probably about 4 weeks, weather permitting. We also have bridges that have not seen any significant rehabilitation since the 50s and are showing their age. And as you state, we unfortunately, the county's by no means unique in this situation, but we live in a time of limited resources. And on an annual basis, decisions have to be made, prioritized decisions have to be made in terms of what we're going to tackle and what we're not. And sometimes those decisions may involve deciding to eliminate a bridge in favor of a higher priority project or a project that has a greater regional significance or serves a greater number of people. So.
And a majority of these 59 bridges are vintage, turn of the century, 1900s, 1910,
some.
Maybe rehabbed once.
Yep.
And to your point, Ryan, we have eliminated at least one bridge about 3 years ago. We're looking at eliminating two bridges, at least one this year, maybe one next year. And it's really not a disservice to the people that use it, but if you have less than 100, 150 cars a day riding back across a bridge, just the preliminary engineering and design and everything for one of the bridges, that $800,000 gets swallowed up.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's $2.5 to $3.5 to $4 million just maybe for a 100-foot long span to put in a brand new bridge.
Correct.
And the money is not ever flowing. It's pretty tight. So we're trying to maximize the money for the bridges that really carry a lot of folks. We own a bridge down in Exeter Township, I think, that carries about 8,000 cars. That's probably our second most heavily used mm-hmm. bridge in Berks County. We do have a bridge in Maiden Creek Township, which is Schaefer Road, or we call it the Blandon Road Bridge, which will be replaced in a couple of years and turned over to Maiden Creek Township. So what we're trying to do is work with our township folks in the townships to hopefully acquire these assets from us, because they have the resources right there at the township shed a mile or two away. They can keep them swept, they can keep them clean, keep them painted. Two of the big indicators of bridge deterioration is the road salts and the winters and lack of proper maintenance. Mm-hmm. You can have them last a bit longer with proper maintenance, just like anything else we own.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I want to reemphasize readingbridges.net, which will give you a walkthrough guide to the bridges that span the city of Reading into West Reading and other parts of the city of Reading. And also, once again, we're here on National County Government Month through NACO, National Association of Counties. And this program tonight was sponsored by South Central Transit Authority, which is now the parent company or the management arm of both BARTA, the Reading and Berks County Bus Transportation Company, and Red Rose out of Lancaster County. Very unique setup there that the two counties came together in the beginning of this year and actually saved millions of dollars for local taxpayers. So, just that quickly, Ryan, I think we're done with infrastructure and transportation. Not the glitziest thing in the world, but it certainly is a way for us to communicate as much as possible. So when people see the detour signs, we hope you are fully informed. So I'm sure next week we'll be back with Jean Tusi and one of her special guests. For tonight, this is County Connection. Thank you.